Take a few deep breaths. As we breathe in, be mindful and present with the in-breath. Be aware of how it feels to breathe in. As we breathe out, be mindful and present with the out-breath. Be aware of how it feels to breathe out. Breathing in and breathing out. Breathing in and breathing out. Regardless of your posture, whether you're sitting upright or leaning over, rub your hands together. How many of you have been to libraries before? I presume all of you have been to libraries before. What do you do in a library? Read books, right? You wouldn't go to the library to sleep. How many of you have been to cinemas before? I'm sure all of us have. When you go to the cinema, what do you go there to do? Some of you go to sleep. If you go to the cinema and sleep, sometimes it's because you really need to, because you are so tired, but you just want to go along with your friends and family. Sometimes it's out of respect because the person is a senior. Sometimes it's because it's your boyfriend or girlfriend, you have no choice. And you don't always get to watch the movie that you like. Sometimes you have to watch movies that you don't like. Sometimes it's movies that you like and you are kept, you know, you don't even think about whether you are going to fall asleep. There's a different kind of cinema called the meditation hall where there's nothing showing. So I can understand if you find it very boring. How many of you find it boring to meditate? It's okay, I'll close my eyes. Raise your hands. But if you do find that closing your eyes, like just staring into nothing and just listening to this voice going, breathe in, breathe out, if you find that initially, at least initially, some of you after a while, you become quite convinced that it's quite good for you. But initially, you may find it quite nonsensical. It's like this is like a cult. Gosh, what did I get myself into, you know? a bunch of folks coming in here and then just sitting there with their eyes closed, and then when you look around, some of them are frowning, and then some of them look very like glazed over, like they're on drugs. You see, meditation. Yeah, meditation is such a mystery. Think about it. If you are in a cinema, you expect something good to happen. Yeah, you expect to be wowed. How many of you have watched the same movie twice? How about three times? Four times? How about five? How about 10 times? I know some of you are Star Wars fans. Yeah. And there are other movies that are good also. Yeah. Good movies deserve a second watch. Is it the same excitement compared to the first watch? If you watch the same movie more than 10 times, you need to see me after this. You need some professional help. No, but there are some movies that really seem to deserve a second watch. But surely, you don't watch it on a daily basis. How many of you watch the same movie every day? If you do, you really need to rethink your life. And if you think about it, meditation is like that, though. Every time you go in, it's more or less the same, you know. The same black screen. Nothing is showing. And that's why it's so exciting when suddenly you sit and that day, suddenly, oh, you see some light, lah, you know. Oh, you have some interesting feeling, you know. That's why people are so amazed by that. Because usually it's the same black screen. All of us have the same black screen, more or less. Otherwise, you get white static. Interestingly, I think 1 or 2 weeks ago, there was a news report about mindfulness being taught in schools. And not in UK, not in US, but in Singapore. I was quite amazed because for a long time, I've been trying to push for mindfulness to be taught in our Buddhist school. We managed to get Fashin Fasi to teach like 6 months to 9 months to a small group, control group. And after that, the results were pretty good. You know, the students benefited from it. They showed an increased, you know, amount of calmness and attention and so on. And we could even say that, no, I correct myself. We have to say that it has been scientifically proven that there is strong correlation. Some would say causation, but scientifically we will just stick to strong correlation first. Yeah, let's not jump the gun. Yeah, in Buddhism we say that this is the immediate condition for that. Yeah, or if you could say it is the cause of that. By meditating, many people have found a way to quieten their mind, but not all of us are ready to be quiet. Yeah. My point exactly. Yeah. And it's simply because we, at different point of our life, we have different needs. Yeah. The Buddha, when he saw a bunch of kids like prodding at some fishes in a pond, he didn't go there and say, "Hey, boy, you must come and learn to meditate, you know. You are not calm. You must observe precepts." He didn't do any of that. He didn't say, "Hey, never attend Dharma school, you know, during the weekends." No, he didn't say that. Instead, he asked them just a few questions. He asked them, "What are you doing?" Firstly, then they said, they just shared very openly what they were doing. You know, prodding at the fish and then, you know, poking at it. Then the Buddha asked, "Well, what if someone do that to you? How would you feel? Would you feel comfortable, you know?" And then they were like, "Oh, that wouldn't be nice, you know, if someone were to take a stick and prod at me." Then he said, "Well, so imagine how the fish is feeling." In a few sentences, he was teaching them empathy. Yeah. And with that, they realized that they were doing something harmful. In the sutta, it's not clear what happened after that. Just like Beauty and the Beast, the recent hoo-ha, Yeah, we don't know what happened to Beauty and Beast after that. Yeah, they never talk about how Beauty and Beast later had to pay COE or not. Yeah, all fairy tales always just talk about that particular incident, that particular period, and after that, that's up to your imagination. In much the same way, strangely, in many of the suttas, it's meant there was a particular teaching point that was given. In this case, for the kids to understand how their actions have effect on others. There was no mention about precepts, no mention about how harming others is this or that, but merely getting the kids to understand. I would reckon that perhaps at that age, and given those circumstances, it was not exactly the right time to teach them about precepts nor meditation. Yeah, so sometimes in the class setting and so on, we have this challenge. Yeah, we have this challenge of trying to have a standardized practice for everybody. If I can, I will teach each of you exactly what you need. Because some of you, maybe what you need now is not meditation. Maybe what you need now is to go and fly kite. So we try. I do organize outing to fly kite. But as a result, I lose those who want to meditate. But there are some of you who don't want to fly kite. You need to just be in the outdoors. Yeah? To appreciate nature because you have been cooped up in the office. So I try. So we try and then we go for outdoors. And then we lose those who are afraid of the sun. In Chinese, long story short, it's called 众口难调. Yeah? 众口难调. Hard to satisfy everybody's needs. Yeah. But when I saw the article about mindfulness being taught in the school, I was quite inspired. Yeah. Inspired in what way? Inspired that, oh, finally, good. The Buddhist practice of meditation have gone one big circle and come back to Asia. It is not taught because Buddhist monks and nuns finally convinced them to teach it, but because they saw studies and reports, they saw similar programs conducted in UK, in Europe, in US and Australia. Yeah, not by temples, but by schools, by doctors, by scientists who have done qualitative analysis. Yeah, showing that there is a strong correlation between those who meditate, yeah, and those who, and how it correlates with the calmness that is observed in classes. Yeah. And we're not talking about deep jhana, half an hour. How long did we meditate just now? Maybe at most 5 minutes. Yeah, at most 5 minutes. Oftentimes we meditate about 20 minutes. And then in the past few months, past maybe one or 2 months, I extended it a little bit more, about half an hour to 40 minutes. Yeah. At which point some of you are like, oh, xiong le, skin it, oh, come so long. on the poster it says, short puja, short meditation, and not so long dharma sharing. Yeah. So today is ming fu wu qi si. Today, the poster befits reality. We have short puja and short meditation. Last week we shared on the concentration, yeah, and we just went through a bit of it. So today I decided that instead of having our usual sitting, I just have a short sitting, and then I want you all to do a simple experiment, yeah. And I need all of you to try it out. Yeah. Because it's like, if you go to a cinema, and then you go there to sleep, nothing wrong lah, I mean you pay for it. But you're not wasting your money, you're wasting your life. If you go to the library and go there to sleep, might as well go back home to sleep. Yeah. If you go to the swimming pool to sleep, okay, don't go to the swimming pool to sleep. Yeah. You'll drown lah. Yeah. So what I need you to do now is, don't go into your samadhi sitting, okay? Whatever position you want, you can move around, but the moment you hear the bell, I want you to stop yourself physically, okay? Don't get ready, okay? Don't get ready. Yeah? Because if halfway through getting ready and your hand is like that and you hear the ding, then you have to sit like that. Okay? And the trick is, it will not be long, okay? It will be very short. But you must hold that position, okay? You must hold that position. Are you all ready? Get yourself ready. Get yourself ready. Oh, cannot move. Okay? And in that position, I want you to observe yourself. Okay? Observe your physical body. Yeah? How does it feel? Do you feel comfortable? Oh, don't move, don't move, don't move. Try not to move. Nothing wrong with moving, really. But just for the sake of exercise, for the sake of understanding yourself better, don't move, then you can understand yourself. Yeah. Okay, now you can move again. Wow. Now, a show of hands, how many of you felt comfortable not moving absolutely? How many of you feel comfortable? On a scale of 1 to 5, 5 being super comfortable, 1 being super uncomfortable, how many of you is above 3? Okay. How many of you is below 3? A bit uncomfortable? The rest, how many of you don't understand what I'm talking about? That is the most common reply. So, what are we observing here? Yeah, what are we observing here? You see, the thing is that when we meditate, we tend to observe ourselves. Don't move. And if you are in a smile, you must maintain that smile. But don't laugh it out. You see, it's easier if you have given half an hour and just... In fact, it's really easier. Trust me, it's really easier. It's not so easy to, at the moment, just bring your mind back. Your boss will not tell you when he's going to fire you, but it can happen. You never know when the car crash is going to happen. You never know when the mental crash is going to happen. You never know when you're going to quarrel with your best friend. You never know when your best friend is going to do something that disappoints you. You never know. You cannot think that, oh, you can be prepared in that way. No. And if reality is that way, that you never know when it will happen, then how can our cultivation be a very prepared way? And that's why in some of the traditions, in particular the Zen tradition, they just keep changing things to throw you off course, throw you off balance. Not trying to be funny. I mean, I cannot deny that maybe some are crazy. But with the right intention, it is to shock your system, to get you to realize that, hey, there's no certainty in anything. And in particular, our day-to-day, we think sitting there long is tough. We think that going to work every day is tough. Wait till you get the letter that you are fired. You think that your relationship is boring. Wait till you get dumped. You know, you think that your house why is your house not bigger? Wait till you need to downsize. You never know. You know, you think that it's very tiring to walk to the MRT station. Wait till something happens and you don't have to walk. You know? Yeah, I mean, touch wood. Of course, we know that touching wood doesn't do anything, but it makes you feel better. If it makes you feel better, I'll touch wood. You know? If it makes you feel better, I'm touching wood. Actually, the formica. This is not really technically wood. This is still not wood. This is rubber. Where's the wood? I can't find raw wood. Rattan. Rattan is as close as it gets. Yeah, this is wood. But then, paper? paper is pulp. It's technically a form of wood. But, so, in meditation, we can go through the formal way of meditation, and we should. And that's why every week we have that sitting meditation. But I want you all to just spend 2 minutes looking at me. 2 minutes, look at me. And think about it. If every week you come here, okay, maybe you don't come here every week, but for the sake of argument, each time you come here, it is like you going to a cinema. You can choose to go there and then start texting your friend, or just reading a book, or do anything you want. Because there's no usher who will come, "Hey, why are you reading a book? Watch leh. Cinema leh. People, hey, watch." In a cinema, nobody does that. And over here, nobody will do that also. But you have to ask yourself, it is your life that you are using up. Today's title, Managing Time and the Perfection of Concentration. Because the practice of meditation, for many people at the get-go, seems such a waste of time. Like I can be doing something else. Now, I know many of you who have meditated for a while, you know that this is not true. But I'm talking about those who have just started or have not even started, and you'll be like, "Hello, what is this? Like, is this going to end? Like, why am I here?" But I want to invite you to consider, even if we sit for 20 minutes, at least you owe it to yourself to try it out for 1 minute. Even if you cannot try for 1 minute, try it for 30 seconds. Even if you cannot try for 30 seconds, at least try for 10 seconds. Because our life, in fact, we can go down to 1 second for a breath. At least observe a breath and really be serious about it. And just observe once. There was once when I shared in one of the school, I kind of went a bit ballistic. Because they were secondary school kids. And sometimes you have to wonder. Just a few weeks ago, I was at Manjushri. And towards the end of the session with them, there was this dance group in the school. They were also secondary school kids in the same school. But when they came in, it was such a different atmosphere. They were respectful of their instructor, of their teacher in charge. By any chance, they were even respectful of me. Many of them are not even Buddhists. But they treated it very seriously when I invited them to just join in for the last session. And it makes me wonder, we should treat the practice with a bit more respect. Yeah, we should. It's just like you go to the library, you don't go and sit on the table, ma. You don't lie on the table to sleep when you go to the library. So why should we allow ourselves to come to the hall and then just do that? We shouldn't. It's about respecting the practice and respecting each other. Yeah. But there was once in Kong Meng San when I was conducting a class, I went quite ballistic. So there was two girls, there was one family and the two girls, two daughters. Yeah. Then I found that sometimes when I do that, it doesn't go down quite well. Then after that, I think I never see them again. we should at least, we owe it to ourselves to at least try it out. And I told some secondary school kids about this before. Why? Because, when I was in secondary school, we had RK. And I always remember one of my friend, Liang Anqi. He asked the teacher, "In Buddhism, we have to get rid of all desire. Then how about the desire to attain enlightenment?" The teacher couldn't answer. And all of us had a good laugh. Because in secondary school, your whole aim of your whole life is to make the teacher look bad. You want to ask some question that the teacher cannot answer. I mean, kids, you know. Yeah, it's a challenge because the teachers are always asking us questions that you cannot answer. You want to ask back some question that they cannot answer. And that was one question that got the teacher dumbfounded, and everybody had a good laugh. But that really stuck in me, you know. So much so that now, 30 years later, I can still remember that occasion. And I'm like thinking, gosh. Now that friend, at some point, he became a Christian. Now this is correlation, okay, not causality. I'm not saying that because he didn't get an answer to that question, he became a Christian. There are many other factors. But what struck me was, later on, at some point, he shared with me about how he became a Christian, and he said that, and this is what he told me, okay? He said that in Christianity, there's a lot of teachings. In Buddhism, he didn't find any teachings. I'm like, huh? And I'm like, which Buddhism did you learn about? Like, how can you say that there's no teachings in Buddhism? And I'll tell you that a lot of this kind of testimony online about how the person was a Buddhist for so many years, he didn't find love, he didn't find compassion, he didn't find this and that. Oh, then in Christ he found everything. Now, I'm not saying that it's wrong for them to find that in Christianity, but I'm saying, like, no, there's something wrong here. Why is this happening? Now, I cannot say I know why it's happening for all of them, because I didn't go and do a study. But I think the first thing we owe to ourselves is we need to know our own faith, our own legacy. Yeah, if we are born into a Buddhist family, we at least should know what this family subscribed to. Yeah. Now, I must admit that if not for ordaining, if not for RK, I would know this much about Buddhism also. If not for RK and ordaining, I would think that Buddhism is all about food, vegetarian food on the 1st and the 15th. That's really what the impression people have. Buddhism is about burning incense, burning joss stick, offering apple and orange and flowers. Yeah, seriously. Because when you go to a temple, you never hear about the Four Noble Truths and the Eightfold Path. Meditation is not something that people talk about. When people talk about it, it was enshrouded in a whole mass of mystery. You know, 这些, wow, 没人就这样, you know. And to begin with, you don't have a monk who speaks a language that you understand. Yes, Shifu, Gong Hokkien Wei. This Shifu, Kilo Gong, Pai Hood, Pai Hood. That's what happened last night. Now, I'm not blaming them. I had some very serious arguments with some senior monks before. I'm a very abrasive person when I need to. And I tell you, there was one senior monk who told me this. He said, do you think those masters don't know how to teach? Do you think they don't know Dharma? He said, they know. It's just that most of them are undereducated. They are not ready for it. Besides literacy being a problem, most of them, people are just struggling to make ends meet, you know. They need spiritual comfort more than spiritual teachings. Back in the days, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, even 50, 60 years ago. I mean, Singapore is only 50 years old, 50 plus years old. So back in the days, people were just struggling. You ask people to sit down and meditate, but it's true, right? Back in the days, for me, back in the days, going to the temple 1st and the 15th of the month was a treat. Because there was really very nice food. Not that home food was not nice, but yeah, it was just very nice. I don't know why. The kari bee hoon and kari zap cai and the cha bee hoon. Wow, just amazing, you know. But nowadays, you give them kari bee hoon, kari zap cai and cha bee hoon. And it's not the food, you know. Today, you give them chocolate, and it's not them in particular, any children. You give any children chocolate, they want to take a look. You think that Rocher is good enough? Huh, Rocher, don't want, thank you. No, thank you. Thank you, Sifu. They want, what do they want? They want Rocher, or the Roque. What is that? The Japanese, the R-O-C-C-E, Royce. Ah, Royce. They want Royce. And they want it, you must remove it from the cold pack. And they open up, and then there's this plastic thing that you dip in it. So how? Yeah, so meditation. In Buddhism, there are three large branches of practices. Jie, Ting, Hui. Precepts, which is the purification of our body and mind, and our body and speech. Then meditation, which is the purification of the mind. And then wisdom, purification of our view. And then all together, then can we see the truth. That's a proper sequence. After this class, in future, if any of you become non-Buddhist, it's okay. For me, I'm really okay. Man. I will not see you in the street, then give you a dirty look. I mean, me and my Dharma senior monk, and I have this similar conversation with many other venerables. Most monks that I met, we have the same mindset. Even if the whole of Singapore become non-Buddhist, become Christian, Taoist or whatever, doesn't matter, I'm still a Buddhist. So, trust me, it's okay. But you must know, especially the young ones, look at me, lie, eye contact. You must know, after this class, if you choose to go to other religion, you cannot, after that, go on stage and say, oh, there was no teaching. there is teaching, okay? You must say that there was teaching, but I didn't learn. So now I found that this one easier to learn, so I try this one. Okay, must say, must remember. Yeah, because, you know, I've heard so many times people spend time in Buddhism, for some reason they never learn. Then after that, try something out. It's actually many times about the feeling. Yeah, because in Buddhism, already this is quite relaxed, you know. For a traditional temple, oh, now mana utang gong wei. Now it's 2 o'clock. For 1 hour, only halfway through the sutra, no, dong 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 dong. So, first, the precepts, then, which is the purification of body and speech, then the mind, then the view. Yeah, but even here, I often highlight, you see how much time we spend on precepts. Only when we are covering precepts, then I talk about precepts. Why? Because the first thing we should expose people to is right view. Nobody full path starts with right view. If they cannot understand what this path is supposed to lead to, then you tell them, cannot do this, cannot do that. They'll be like, why? That's why people keep asking us why. And then we have to spend so much time explaining why. If you start off with explaining to them the bigger picture of where we are headed to, then they will not ask so much why. Not that you force them not to ask, but because they understand why they have to do it. Then it will make sense. I did a social experiment recently in the urban retreat. We had a 3-day retreat. And you notice, if y'all look around, do y'all see any pattern here? You shouldn't see any pattern because there's no pattern here. In a traditional setting, men will be seated on one side, women on the other side, and all men will be in front. If there's enough men, you will fill up the whole front rows. That's the norm for many temples. SGC is not the norm. But it's not because I don't respect that norm that I choose this format. It's because over the years, I have observed that when people come to the temple, because of that artificial segregation, people feel disconnected, both with the friend that they come with, or they feel disconnected from one another. So I explicitly, you know how many months I had to tell the volunteers and the staff back then not to enforce any of this. Yeah. So today, you can sit freely. Men, women, all over the place. Because I trust that none of you are going to do something funny over here. Right? I mean, you know what I mean? It's Sunday afternoon. You can be anywhere. You choose to come here. I trust that you are in the right frame of mind. But many times you go to the temple, you are scolded for the smallest thing about this rule, that regulation, this like that, how you wear, what, how you sit. You know what I'm saying? So the first thing we have to share with people is about the view, world view. What does Buddhism stand for? What is the end goal? Why does Buddhism exist at the first place? What are we trying to achieve? You tell people we are trying to help one another to be really happy, free of suffering. Hey, that sounds like a good idea. Why not? Who can disagree with that? But you tell them, cannot do this, cannot do that. Why? Why cannot eat? Why cannot do this? Why cannot? And for that matter, why must we sit down here like that? You know what I'm saying? Yeah, that's why the reason, the why, the view is very important. It's because in Buddhism, we say that a lot of our troubles, a huge part of our troubles come from the agitation in our mind. Because we don't see things correctly. Yeah? And so, if we don't see things correctly, we tend to interpret things in a certain way. In ways that cause us to see it and become upset over it. But why do we say that? Because think about it. Think about the last time you get upset over something. Did that incident upset everybody? In all likelihood, no. Yeah? Your mother don't let you play with handphone? Who get upset? You get upset. Mother don't get upset. Yeah? Few siblings. Mother or father don't let all of you play handphone? Not all the children will get upset. Why? Because we interpret the same situation differently. Simple example, isn't it? Two person at work, one person get promoted, the other person didn't get promoted. Or let's say both didn't get promoted, one happy, one not happy. Why? Because maybe the one who is not happy have been going for wanting for promotion. The other one want to slow down. If you want to slow down and you don't get promoted, wow, good. Yeah? But if you are like trying to leave a mark in the industry and you don't get promoted, you get disappointed. A lot has to do with how you perceive things. And that's why in Buddhism we say, hey, you need to do something about the mechanism that you are using to analyze things, namely our mind. We tend to see things through colored glasses. That's the joke that I'm sure you all have heard before about this couple who move in a place, and then what happened? The husband commented about the neighbor's laundry. Why is our neighbor always putting up dirty laundry? Then the wife looked at it, then kept quiet. Second day, same thing happened. For a whole week. Yeah. Then, 1 week later, the husband commented, hey, strange, today our neighbors have put up clean laundries finally. Then asked the wife, hey, you notice? Then the wife looked at the husband and said, I just cleaned the windows today. For those who don't get it, I can't help you. Some jokes are not meant to be explained. Yeah. So similarly, the practice of meditation is simply that. To help us clean our mind. Purify it. The word we use is purify it. But what has purification of the mind got to do with sitting there quietly? It is because we tend to have a lot of discursive thinking involuntarily. Commentary. It's like those sports channel, you know. Yeah. And we don't have just one sportscaster in our mind. We have multiple conflicting sportscaster. And then anything we see, hear, smell, taste, touch, or even from the past that we think about, we start to comment. And you comment enough, it's like advertisement, you know. You start to believe in it. And that's the problem. We brainwash ourselves. You have a bad experience with someone, then when you're in a car, in a train, in a bus, waiting for the lift, then you start to think about it. This person said this. Don't like me, right? And the same thing happens when you tell someone. If you tell the wrong person, then that person with the best intention try to support you. So it's, yalo, how can he like that? Then, wow, it feels like it's true, you know. When you tell yourself, there's no one else to disagree with you, then it becomes self-reinforcing, you know. You tell us, you go through the same event 10 times, then it becomes really real. Wow, the person is out to get you, you know. And sometimes you are so convinced that the person has this or that intention. The person says, really? What? Can you remind me again what happened that day? And then the person who is so convinced because of that process would may even say, hey, you damn good, no, you act blur, are you? Right? Sometimes we are like that. Sometimes we see people doing that. Sometimes we are on the other side of the equation. And we're like, what did I do? What is that? Outside, huh? Oh, same guy is here. So, the process of meditation, as I've shared, did I use this? We forgot to bring. So it wasn't here lah. Okay. It's okay. I'll bring from my mind. Today is... don't worry. It's here. Not 26. Last week is 19 ma. We went through this. Correct? So last week we went through quite a bit, yeah. And we ended with just a brief touch on the different types of meditation, namely the first type samatha, second type vipassana. So the first type samatha, it leads to samadhi, which is a state where the mind is quiet. The mind is free of discursive thinking. Yeah, this brings about think. And this leads to hui. Prajna or wisdom. Samadhi itself, also known as Denshi. Oh, and last week, I made a mistake here. Thanks to Thomas, where's Thomas, for highlighting to me. This is wrong. If you copy it down, I must correct myself. Xing Lü. Because it's Si Lü de Lü. Yeah. He's very kind. He didn't. He after class waited. Then when we were outside, then he asked me, "Shifu, that Lü, is it the other one? Then I was like, huh? Maybe can also." Then after that in the car, I immediately check. Oh, okay, wrong. Yeah. So, 静虑. So, when we practice samatha, the whole process is about taming the mind, quietening it. Yeah, because when the mind is active, there's actually nothing wrong with the mind being active. The Buddha's mind also functioned. Yeah? The difference is because of the momentum that we have. The momentum of our mind, typically, for unenlightened beings, is it tends to go haphazardly. And because of past tendencies, the moment we are active, our mind tend to misinterpret, tend to be colored, tend to take things strongly, and then misconstrue things. And so the first step of the practice is quieten all processes first. Sort of restart the system, you know. Yeah, kill all the programs. Stop all the programs. Then after that, reload new programs. Yeah, in a way, the first step is this. Finish up all the programs. Stop all programs. Yeah, so in this light, then you consider, sit there quietly, close your eyes, and don't anyhow think about this or that, but just focus your mind on something very calming, somewhat boring, your breath. Then it makes sense why we use that. Because if we ask you to think about your work, wow, a lot of emotions, a lot of thinking start. Ask us, even when you talk about cultivation of loving kindness and compassion, we don't immediately say think about your family. Cannot. The more you think about family, wow, a lot of story come up. Yeah, then your mind becomes so busy. So there are specific techniques to quell different states of the mind. When the mind is overly active, you use certain techniques under this, yeah, specifically to quieten it. But sometimes you over quieten it, it becomes sleepy. Then you must arouse it. Yeah? 直觉舍. Then you must, the second part, arouse it. Energize it. Yeah, so meditation is not always about just quietening, then, wah, 谢谢. No. The trouble is, for most people, we never quite manage to quieten it. So the teacher cannot teach you the second part. Yeah, so in the lineage that I was trained in, the second part is very simple. You just initially recite some sutras to excite the mind, yeah, to energize the mind. And if you are familiar with certain verses, then you do reflection. Yeah. By reflecting on the Dharma, then your mind can become excited. But again, Dharma, is it interesting to reflect? For some of you, yeah, but for most people, what a beki leh. Yeah, some of us may not even cannot even remember the concept, then how to reflect? That's why the path of wisdom is threefold also. Wen, Si, Xiu. First, you must hear, but the hearing part involves retention. You must listen and then you must remember. You cannot remember, then you cannot reflect. Yeah. If you cannot remember, you cannot claim to have knowledge of anything. Yeah. So after hearing, you must remember. Then you have knowledge of it. But after that, you must reflect on the knowledge. Then you can have understanding. If you just remember but don't have reflection on it, that means you cannot derive the principle. In which case, you don't have a full understanding. You just have knowledge of people's understanding. That's just knowledge. But if you can reflect further, then you can have understanding. And the side effect is that your mind becomes energized. But it must be moderated also. Not too much of reflection, otherwise it again becomes discursive. So by tempering these two, yeah, by managing these two, then the mind can become in this state of equilibrium, where it's clear, alert, yeah, but not agitated, calm, quiet, but not dull. Then at that point, the Buddha says, the third part, 直举舍. Yeah, sa, that means you can forego either of the practices and just abide in that quietude. Mm. And again, most people never reach this part, so most of the time we are not taught this part. Not because there's no such a part. Why Shifu talk about so many different things? Usually just quieten the mind. Why? Because most people never manage to quieten the mind. And why quieten the mind? Because our habitual momentum is that the moment the mind is active, we tend to think wrongly. We tend to jump to conclusion. We tend to form perceptions quicker than what should be. We try to draw conclusion that is actually not there. Yeah. So these are, in a way, erroneous programs that's running in the mind. So the first step here actually shut down all these programs. And then after that, when the mind, the programs are all cleaned up, then we restart fresh. And that's why, for many people, when they go for some meditation practice, after the practice, they feel very, very clear. And they see that, they look at the same problem, that's an answer. Because now, we are not so cluttered with all the wrong programs running, you know. Yeah. Then the next part will be Hui. Yeah, Hui Guan. Yeah, what we call Vipassana. This is none other than tapping on to the first part where the mind is clear. Then you're going to observe again what you have heard. What you have heard of and understood. The first part, Wen Shi. Then you have knowledge and understanding. The third part, in cultivation, you can reflect further and then observe directly to verify. To verify what you have heard. You heard that, all formations are impermanent. You heard this, you heard that, but it's just a concept. It's just knowledge. Yeah, you reflected, it makes sense. Yeah, you can understand the principle. It all connect very well. But you must still see it in action. Only when you see it in action, then you verify clearly that this is the way. When you have verified, then you have attained the truth. Yeah, and the function of that is your faith becomes affirmed. All doubts is removed. Yeah, all doubts is removed. Yeah, then your inner peace becomes affirmed as well. Otherwise, there will always be that a bit of uncertainty, and it's arising because of the doubt. Yeah, and then from there, the initial verification is insufficient. Then repeatedly, you do this process again and again, until all shreds of doubts is totally removed. Yeah, as they say, remove until there's no shred of doubts. Yeah. Then you can say, yes, that's, you see it as it is. Yeah. Then at that point in time, no matter who come and tell you this or that, you're okay. Yeah. You will not hesitate, you will not be defensive, you will not have to go and put this, like, make attacks or whatever. Yeah. And if people cannot accept, okay, so be it. So, I kind of skipped one important ritual. Who is new here today? Anyone new here today? Yes. Hello. Tell us your name and how you got to know about this group cultivation. There's no sound that you can hear, but it's going to go into the recording.
Hello, everyone. My name is Kim, and I'm a Guoke, meaning I do not live in Singapore for the time being. But I'm very happy and very fortunate to be able to be here today to join the session. And definitely I benefited a lot from Fasu's teaching on contemplation and understanding impermanence, always be ready for the impermanence of life. And And I hope and look forward to having more opportunity to be able to join you all.
No.
Whatever
no.
the
you,
opportunity
you,
arises.
Not that thing.
You. Thank you very much.
I have to press, ah. Yes,
no.
Do I need
can you hear?
To speak,
can right. Don't have to ask. Press anything. Yeah. Don't press anything.
Okay. Okay. My name is Kevin Tan.
Can hear.
我比较习惯讲华语啊。可以。我是机缘巧合会来到这边，是因为最近发生一些事情啊，通过介绍我认识法师，然后今天有机会来这边学习佛法。我对佛教是正如你所说一知半解啊，很模糊的一个概念呢，所以我是希望从这边我可以学习多一些，认识多一些。 佛教的理念，还有认识多一些，希望能够得到大家的指点呢。好，谢谢大家。Wow,
who is so excited? Melody, right? Oh, what's Kim? Kimberly and Kelvin. Yeah. Ah. Welcome. Who else is here for the first time? Anyone else? Let me see. I think all season parking holder. The rest have come before. How about, have you introduced yourself? Then, 来啦. What's your name? My name is Jesse. And how did you get to know about this group?
I saw it on Facebook.
Ah, I see. You saw it on Facebook? Okay. So, are you in my friend group or in whose friend
your
group?
Your friend group.
Ah, I see. Okay.
I attend your class before.
Oh, which class?
Sing class.
Hasutra. Huh? I see. Good to see you again. Welcome. So how long have you seen the posting?
Yesterday.
Oh, just yesterday. I see. Good. So we have to post it on Facebook. Yeah. So usually we have our short chanting, short meditation. Then I will do this, get people to introduce themselves. This practice started off back in 2006 or 2007. When I first gave classes in Singapore Buddhist Federation. And then I think it was the second or third year class. And for the first lesson, it was a small group, smaller than this. So I got them to introduce themselves. And at the end of the class, some of them together with the class monitor came forward and thanked me. And I was like, yes? And they were thankful that I asked them to introduce themselves because before that they don't know each other. Yeah. And this is quite common. Yeah, in the Buddhist circle, you can go to a temple for 10, 20 years and you don't know anybody and nobody know you. Yeah. Occasionally you may know someone, you may talk to somebody, but usually it's a very lonesome process. Yeah. You go there, people maybe smile at you, not at you, or scold you. Yeah, but you usually come and go by yourself. Yeah. So in SGC, we try to break away from that cycle. Not because Shifu is into socializing or whatever, but because at the core of the Buddhist teaching is love and compassion. Yeah, we say, 愿一切众生离苦得乐. Yeah, may all sentient beings be free of suffering and attain to happiness. But within the small circle, if we cannot even reach out to one another, then what more about all sentient beings? Yeah. So in the past few months, we have gone through the different paramitas. Yeah. So this is one of them, yeah, the perfection of concentration. Yeah. I included a title management of time. Yeah, management of time. Because in the case of meditation, oftentimes we may feel like, hey, Shifu, no time leh. Very busy lah. Correct? Those of you who are laughing, you know. No, actually, how many of you meditate on a regular basis? Like daily basis? So, I must do this exercise again. How many of you meditate once a week? All of you should raise your hand, because if you attend it once a week, you know, 6 times a week, 5 times, at least 5 times, at least. If you meditate every day, then you can also raise your hand. 4 times a week, 3 times. How come suddenly you raise your hand? If it's 3 times, then at least 5 times you can also raise your hand. If you meditate 3 times a week, right, and I ask at least 5 times, Sifu is wrong. Okay, up to 7 times a week. Up to 7 times a week, all of you should raise your hand. Up to 6 times a week. Up to. I said one. Okay, 3 times. 2 times. 1 times. 1 time. 7 times a week means you meditate daily. Yeah. Anyway. Maybe it's the way I ask questions. Is it very complicated, the way I ask questions? I always thought that I try to make it simpler, you know. So, time management. Recently, a friend shared this idea with me. It's called getting things done. Yeah, thanks to my longtime friend, Yong-hee. He chanced upon something called getting things done. Yeah. But there's a parallel between the getting things done and what I've been teaching. So when he shared with me, I was like, yeah, that's what I've been advocating. Some of you may have attended my meditation class before, and you will recall the 2 questions I asked you all. Like, sometimes when we meditate, there'll be some thoughts that arise in us. Yeah, thoughts about meaningful, important things. Why do I say meaningful, important things? Usually when we meditate, we would have a lot of thoughts. And sometimes we are made to think that those thoughts are frivolous, not important, we should cast them away. But I want you to ask yourself carefully. There may be some thoughts that are frivolous. What is today's date again? So question 1 and question 2. Just these 2 simple questions. Does it need to be solved immediately? Can it be solved immediately? Yeah. Only when it's yes to both answer, both questions, then must you do it. If not, you should just put it aside. Sometimes we can solve it immediately, but we don't need to solve it immediately, because it doesn't need to be solved immediately. Many times our time throughout the day is wasted on things that you can solve immediately, but you don't need to solve immediately. For example, at work, halfway through, when you're doing something, then suddenly, message come in. it's something that you can solve immediately, you can look at it, but do you need to look at it immediately? Don't need to. You shouldn't look at it only at night, but you should finish up at least one chunk of what you're doing before you attend to it. Yeah. This is called the anti-multitasking thesis. Yeah. The whole idea of multitasking is actually detrimental to our mental health. Because multitasking... Hello. So happy, look at her. The whole idea of multitasking is context switching. You switch away from what you are doing to do something else. That whole process is not just about you doing something else. But the moment you want to do something else, your mind have to unload all the whole context, the whole sequence of what you have done so far, unload the whole thing, and then reload all the necessary information and knowledge to deal with that new item. So that is cognitive load, if you will. And then resolve it. The worst thing is you resolve that halfway, and then you try to do a third thing. And then you cycle between these three things. What happened? A lot of your mental strength, mental energy is wasted, loading, unloading, loading, unloading, and trying to remember where you stopped. So instead of doing that, does it need to be solved immediately? No need. Okay, forget it. Yeah. But not to totally forget it. So I've been sharing with people, when something pop up in your mind, write it down. Yeah, just write it down. If you want, if you are using iPhone, there's something called, there's a task, I think there's a to-do or task app inside. Yeah, they have lists and reminders. Lists are basically categories, and then you can put reminders into the list. Yeah, and the list can be activated on time, yeah, date and time, or on location. Yeah, so it's very, quite amazing. Android apps also have a similar function. Yeah, so you put a note, like let's say, when I go back, feed my child. So you tag to your home location, when you go back, don't feed my child. Okay, go and feed your child. Yeah. So the point is, what has this got to do with what we are talking about so far? I actually use this in meditation classes. Yeah, because when you're meditating, then your thoughts, all the things you are preoccupied seem to be so glaring, you know. Yeah. And for many people, it's a struggle. Meditate, then a lot of thoughts. Yeah. So when thoughts arise repeatedly, yeah. Usually if thoughts arise, you should be able to resolve them fairly quickly. But it is the recursive ones. Yeah. When they are recursively coming again and again. Yeah. And then you ask yourself this two simple questions. And again, if you really find that there's something that needs to be solved immediately and can be solved immediately, should you stop your meditation? Yes, you should. You should just go and solve it, you know. Yeah, you should. But think about it. Early in the morning when you want to meditate, or late at night when you want to meditate, are there so many things that need to be solved immediately? Most of the things don't need to be solved immediately. The truth is. Of course, if you say, I can attain enlightenment immediately. Any of you can attain enlightenment immediately? Anyone? Yeah, if you can, just attain enlightenment immediately. Okay, don't wait for Shifu. Don't wait for next SGC. Just attain enlightenment. Then you can come in as guest speaker. Also, yeah, so something similar like this appears in getting things done. Yeah, the framework. Yeah, and you can use this not just in meditation, but in your day-to-day life. Yeah, and this is a very simple form of time management. Yeah, so that you don't waste your time on a lot of things, then and end up switching here and there. Yeah, end up switching here and there. So I want to invite you to again stop. I want you to note what you are doing now. And just before you hear the bell, what was the thought that you have? Try to recall the thought that you have. And then ask yourself, can you remember the chain of events before that thought? For some of us, maybe we were reflecting about these two questions. For others, maybe we were drifting away. Yet for others, you may be thinking like, hey, already past 2:30 leh. Now in this short 1 or 2 minutes, did you feel comfortable physically? For some of you, yes, because you were just sitting. For some of you, were adjusting and tung, and then you... So, even if you are sitting in the most comfortable position, yeah, in actual fact, most people think that meditation is uncomfortable. It's not meditation that is uncomfortable. It is the fact that we are so used to allowing ourselves to move whenever we like. Not letting ourselves do that, then we feel uncomfortable. On top of that, of course, there's the leg cramp or leg numbness part. Yeah? But I assure you, you can bring next week, we are not having class here. Okay, we are not having SGC here. Yeah, next week they are having Qingming celebration in the main center. So we'll announce again whether next week, whether we are going to have SGC outdoors or over at Buddhist Library. Yeah. So keep a lookout on the chat group. Yeah, but if you want to bring your couch when we are outdoors, you can also bring. The point is, even if you bring your couch and you sit very comfortably, I assure you, if you don't move after 15 minutes, you also feel uncomfortable. The most comfortable chair will not be comfortable if you have to sit still for long. So why do we do that? Yeah, because we do that because before you can move, your mind must move. And here we are trying to quieten the mind. And if you are moving, it means your mind is by default not quiet already. It cannot be much quiet if it's moving randomly. Yeah, and hence the initial part about, okay, at least keep still. And again, it's not about keeping still. It's that when you try to keep still, then you may notice the function, the moving of the mind. When you allow yourself to move as it is, you can't observe it. But when you say, try not to move, then you find yourself resisting. Then from that resistance, you can see, there is an urge to move. Then it's easier to observe the movement of the mind. And from there, you can observe what triggered you to move. If you cannot even observe why you are moving your hand, I don't think it's easy to observe why you scold someone, why you acted in this way or that way. Because even a simple thing like moving your hand, moving your body, if we are not aware of that, hard for us to be aware on a day-to-day basis, other more grosser movement. No? Next week, we'll announce again, no? We'll announce the location, and then we'll continue on this topic. And most likely, it'll be outdoors. Then we can have some walking also. All right? Anybody have any questions to ask or share? If not, put your palms together.
愿消三障诸烦恼，愿得智慧真明了，普愿罪障悉消除，世世常行菩萨道。阿弥陀佛，起立。